When it comes to IRA assets that are payable to a trust, things can get tricky. This is a presentation especially for trustees who want to learn a little bit more about some of the horror stories of managing IRAs that are payable to a trust. This can also help individuals who have IRAs that they want to have payable to trusts as beneficiaries, or advisors or attorneys who simply wish to understand more about IRAs payable to trust. So what we're going to do in this episode is track the results of a recent private letter ruling which illustrated some of the effects of bad advice for an IRA that was payable to a trust. I'm Griffin Bridgers, and this is 10 Minutes with Griffin. For today's episode, episode 213, we're going to look at a recent private letter ruling, PLR 2021-25007, which dealt with the issue of an inherited IRA and trust, and illustrated that you can't make rollover distributions from any inherited IRA. Now, as always, this presentation is not intended to substitute for legal or tax advice and is provided for educational purposes only. A little bit about me. I serve two buckets. I provide tailored estate planning and tax education to the legal industry and the financial planning industry. And I'm also an attorney providing tax and estate planning services to clients in Colorado and Tennessee through my law firm, Hutchinson Associates LLC. So if you want to learn more about tailored education, you can email me at my personal address, griffin.bridgers@gmail.com. If you're in need of legal representation on the tax or estate planning side, you can email me at gbridgers@hutchinslaw.com. Jumping back to the presentation, it helps to set a groundwork of some of the distribution rules that surround IRAs. So if you have a distribution from an IRA to an individual owner or beneficiary, it's typically going to be subject to income tax. Plus, if you're an employee who's funded an IRA and you take an early distribution that doesn't qualify for an exception under Code Section 72T, you could have an additional 10% penalty tax that applies on top of the ordinary income tax you'd have to pay. Now, for IRAs that are funded with the wage income of an employee, there are some rollover options which keep you from being taxed on distributions. For one, the employee can roll over any distribution to a new IRA within 60 days. Similarly, the spouse of the employee has an option, if they're the beneficiary, to roll over the IRA to their own personal spousal IRA. And in either case, the distribution isn't going to be subject to income tax. However, if you exceed that 60-day period, or you're not a spouse, or there's no spousal rollover, then that distribution could be taxed. Now, importantly, if the beneficiary of the IRA is the one receiving the distribution and they're not a spouse or there's no spousal rollover, it's treated as an inherited IRA, and that takes away the rollover option. In other words, the beneficiary can't be the middle person to take charge of IRA distributions, then roll them over into a new IRA or an inherited IRA. Instead, all distributions from inherited IRAs are going to be taxable, other than direct trustee-to-trustee transfers to new inherited IRAs. And it was that exact principle that was illustrated in PLR 2021-25007. So in this private letter ruling, we had a surviving spouse who had a spousal rollover IRA and named a trust as beneficiary. So spouse dies, trust becomes irrevocable, IRA is payable to the trust. And what happened here is that the trustees needed to trade the stocks within the IRA, but the IRA custodian told them they can't unless the IRA assets are transferred to another account. Now, the private letter ruling didn't expand on what the custodian meant by another account. It's implied that maybe what the custodian was getting at is they had to roll it into a trading non-IRA account. And the trustees, in reliance on that advice, did exactly that. They transferred the funds to a non-IRA investment account for trading purposes. Then, once the goof was realized several months later, this ruling request was submitted to the IRS to essentially reverse the transfer and put the funds back into the old IRA or into a new inherited IRA. But what happened is that the IRS said no. Why? Well, essentially, In the case of an inherited IRA, you can't put the toothpaste back into the tube. In this case, the IRA became an inherited IRA at the spouse's death, so there's no rollover permitted. So as a result, the only thing you could do is have a direct trustee-to-trustee transfer to a different IRA. Now, I want to note real quick that we have two different terms that are conflicting when we look at this. When I say direct trustee-to-trustee transfer, I'm not referring to the trustee of the trust. I'm referring instead to a term that's synonymous with the custodian or trustee of the IRA itself. So in other words, the transfer has to be directly from IRA to IRA. It can't be to an intermediary account in any way or to any beneficiary, as you might see with a rollover distribution for an employee who owns an IRA. So, as a result of the IRS saying no, the entire distribution was subject to federal income tax, which was payable at the very high trust ordinary income tax rates, because the brackets for trusts are much more highly compressed and are missing a couple intermediary brackets you'd see otherwise with individuals. And there could have been state income tax here too as well, but we don't know in what state the trust was being administered. And even though there was no actual distribution from the trustees to the trustees or to the beneficiaries of the trust, this transfer to an account that was controlled by the trustees of the trust itself was still treated as a distribution instead of a trustee-to-trustee transfer. In other words, you can't have any sort of an intermediary account or placeholder non-IRA account for that trustee-to-trustee transfer. It can't be trustee to account to trustee. It has to be trustee-to-trustee to avoid any tax on that distribution from an inherited IRA. So what are some additional notes and takeaways here? Well, for one, if this had not been an inherited IRA, there may have been relief available to allow for a late rollover. Now, the text of the letter ruling says that it was several months between the transfer to the investment account, the non-IRA account, and when this letter ruling was requested. So, based on that several months nomenclature, it seems like they're past the 60 days anyway. And if this had not been an inherited IRA, there could have been potentially some relief if the trustees could show reasonable reliance on a tax professional's guidance. Now, most likely that wouldn't have been here because what the trustees relied on were the custodian's advice, which typically doesn't fly in that reasonable reliance scenario. You have to have advice from a CPA or attorney that you reasonably rely on, which is faulty. Another thing here is that trustees really have to be careful here and learn how to balance their duties. And there's lots of moving parts here. It's easy to inadvertently trigger income tax, even when you're just simply doing things right. Because the irony here is that the trustees probably had the duty to take charge of these assets and diversify the IRA investments. And they're simply trying to do so. And the fact that they couldn't trade stocks within the IRA makes me think this was probably a directed IRA. Or had some significant non-liquid asset that they wanted to get rid of itself in order to diversify. But once again, that's reading between the lines and isn't apparent in the facts. And ironically here too, even though a trust was involved, the taxability of the distribution immediately kept us from having to really look into the required minimum distribution rules that would otherwise be the big hot and button issue that you have to look at with trusts that are beneficiaries of an IRA. So most likely post-Secure Act, the tax treatment of this without the distribution, without this mess up, would have been that probably by the 5th anniversary of the spouse's death, or maybe if they're lucky, the 10th anniversary of the spouse's death, there would have had to have been a distribution and tax on that distribution from the IRA. And what's happening right now indicates that this could potentially be beneficial for the trust, because we're facing the specter of tax rates going up. So it could very well be the case that when we reach that 5th anniversary or 10th anniversary, the ordinary income tax rate is much higher, and in that case, the trust might end up better off having taken this distribution now and been taxed on it, and then investing the net proceeds in capital gain types of assets, which may still be taxed at a lower rate, depending on what happens with capital gain reform. Now, we don't know. That's looking too much into a crystal ball I don't have, but sometimes what looks like a screw-up on its face can ultimately end up being something that was beneficial, maybe by accident, but it's still a good outcome. So hopefully whoever was involved here isn't going to go after the trustees and try to seek any breach of fiduciary duty or anything like that. As always, if you have questions not related to client-specific questions or topic suggestions, you can email those to me at griffin.bridgers@gmail.com. Thanks again for listening to this episode of 10 Minutes with Griffin, and I look forward to seeing you in the next one.